Hey Gen Zers, this is Mackenzie Amyx with today's Gen Z with Mackenzie, and today we're joined by Kama Hagar, who is a yoga instructor, wellness coach, and the founder of Mukama Botanica Skincare. Welcome, Kama.
Hi Mackenzie, thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, of course. So you grew up in Maui. Can you tell us, how did your lifestyle and your family affect the way that you are now?
Absolutely. So I actually grew up kind of in a tri-form area. I grew up between the Bay Area, actually Cabo San Lucas, Mexico, and Maui, Hawaii. So I was so lucky to have experienced so many different kinds of cultures and ecosystems and beautiful people. To me, Maui is the nearest and dearest to my heart. It's home. I went to study Hawaiian healing, and I was just so connected with everything, the culture, the plants, the lifestyle, the laid backness, the community, and all these beautiful things that really sculpted who I am and the work I put out today.
That's awesome. So can you tell us, when did you start learning about, like you said, Hawaiian healing and yoga and spirituality and that sort of thing? When did you start getting interested in that?
Yeah, I started getting interested in all of this actually at a really young age. I always tell this funny story about when I was probably like 4 years old. We had this big Buddha statue in our backyard in Maui, and I used to just go and try to finagle my legs into lotus position and do meditation. And I was really drawn to it, but no one in my family really did it, though they had some spiritual beliefs. And we talked astrology, and we definitely were into manifestation and the more kind of big picture, creative, ethereal stuff. But yeah, no one really taught me to do that. It was later in life, I found yoga first, that I really decided to pursue that. It was the only workout I could force myself to do. I loved that you could connect to something bigger along the way. It was not just moving your body and sweating to get good abs or whatever it was. It was just actually connecting to your body and connecting to source, actually, which is just so unique. Then I kept spiraling and spinballing, and I ended up studying all of these modalities for myself out of just sheer interest, and every teacher I had said, you need to teach. So here I am.
Great. That is incredible. So it seems like you had a very open-minded, sort of free-spirited family. So when you started pursuing these things, they were definitely in support of it. But did you ever, growing up, sort of doubt all of these beliefs of like a higher purpose and connectivity sort of thing? Did you have those doubts, or were you always sort of in line with that?
That's a great question. Early in my life, my dad's side of the family was very traditional, kind of Christian. He wasn't so much, but I saw a lot of that. And I loved the idea of a greater faith. And I remember trying really hard to be Christian or to find some kind of traditional religious faith. I really wanted it. So I started exploring. I started reading different scriptures of all kinds of religions. And I loved pieces and parts of all of them, but I didn't feel identified with one specific one. So when I was searching, I was looking, I knew there was something bigger, but what was it? And I still don't know the answer to that. I think it's part of my spiritual belief that there are so many different deities and gods and practices, and that you take what fits and you take the best and the most beautiful from all of them, and you take those as your practices. So were there doubts? Not necessarily, but it was more just me finding the space that I resonated with.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So like you said, taking pieces and parts of different religions, how have your beliefs kind of changed as you've grown?
Yeah, so they have probably changed a million times, but also not changed at all. I think it was more me trying to identify with something that didn't fit. I always actually joke that throughout my actual specifically spiritual, more yogic, more meditation endeavors, I ended up joining like 5 cults by accident. And it's just part of the spiritual path. If you're really exploring and you're open-minded, you could end up in some places you aren't going to stay, but that's okay. Like the whole time was me knowing, okay, I didn't get too deep. It was just realizing like, okay, this isn't for me. I'm not this diehard about anything. I'm definitely more of a, there's no one size fits all. Let me pick my practice and and flow from there.
That's very interesting. So when did you start studying yoga and training to become like a yoga instructor and a yoga master?
Yeah, so 2018, I started all of my certifications, none of which I thought would lead me to teaching, which I should rewind back a little bit. And I studied fashion design. So I have a degree in fashion, and that was the thing that I thought would be my life's path. I wanted to empower people to feel beautiful and to express themselves and to be creative and to show up boldly and beautifully in the world. And all of these things I realized through going down the fashion and beauty rabbit hole, you could do from the inside out. So that was really the big shift for me. And I started finding myself not really feeling connected to the fashion and beauty world and finding that it actually beats a lot of people down. So how could I switch that? Well, I got my degree in beauty industry management and business, and I actually launched an all-natural organic skincare line. So at that time, I was still looking at it through the lens of beauty, mm-hmm. but I was thinking there's something deeper than this, and I don't know if I want to be in the beauty world. How do I transition?
That's and really interesting. Yeah.
My work is wellness. So I ended up moving that to the wellness world, finding so many beautiful retreats to sponsor and spa and all of these things. And from there, I started studying. And like I said, I did it for me. I studied yoga. I got my 200-hour through Yoga Works, unplugged meditation. I was the first group of students there. I studied under David G, who is world renowned, all for just myself, like I said. And then my next one was my Hawaiian healing studies. And then after that, it was Reiki. So all of those were for me until every teacher literally like grabbed me by the shoulders and was like, teach. Here I am teaching.
Yeah, awesome. So I think what's really interesting about that is that you kind of have always known what you've wanted to do, which is to empower people and make them feel beautiful. But it's really interesting to me that you sort of switched your focus, and originally you thought you were going to go for more of outwardly beauty, and you kind of switched completely, just reversing it, but it's still that same goal. And I think that's really incredible. Seems like you're a very focused person and you know exactly how to help people. So about all these practices that you've learned, I think most people know what yoga is, but can you tell us exactly what Reiki and Hawaiian healing are?
Absolutely. So, oh my gosh, Reiki and Hawaiian healing, I break it down like this. Through all of my studies, each one covered a really important dimension of self. And I didn't know that until I looked back at them in hindsight, but my Hawaiian healing studies were the most spiritual studies I have ever done. Hawaiian healing is a lot of working with the elements. It's working with nature. It's working with plants and using them as medicine, be it through a tea or just beautiful body scrubs and ointments and beautiful things like this, that we actually work with the vibration of the plant. The Hawaiians are super connected with their ancestral lineage. So it's calling upon spirit and your ancestors to guide you in any moment. And you can do that in any moment. And it's working just really with this powerful sacred lineage that is so specific and so underrated. Like nobody talks about this culture. We use a lot of mantra, which is a mind instrument. It's a word, it's a phrase that we meditate on. We use a lot of that from Sanskrit or from India. But there are beautiful mantras and Hawaiian words that we can use in meditation or just as empowering practices from the Hawaiian language. So there are all these things. There's also dance and there's chant and there's all these just wonderful things. So that's generally Hawaiian healing. And then moving into Reiki, that was my emotional training ground. That was the work that I didn't realize. Oof, like after my Reiki training, I was emotional. It was like it brought up so much in me. And I feel that way when I do work on myself and when I do Reiki on others, that it brings up just all of the emotional release and all of those things that need healing that yoga, meditation, and Hawaiian healing can't even do. So Reiki is a touchless energy work, and it's from a Japanese lineage. It's one of those beautiful practices that's taught from teacher to teacher and handed down. And it's this beautiful transmission of energy, of pure loving energy that you give to help someone heal physically or emotionally.
That's incredible. So you mentioned that you started learning about all of these and training for these practices back in 2008. So it's only been 2 years. So noticeably, how have you noticed yourself and your mindset has changed since 2018 to now?
So much. Every day I am learning more and more. It's a dedication. I just got the best compliment yesterday from someone I really admire who said that you just walk your talk so much, and that's the best thing I could ever ask for, because as a teacher, that's so important. I really, really, really want to be in there. I want to be in the mud with my students. I want to be learning all of the things that I am teaching too. I won't even speak to things that I don't feel confident in. There are times where I've had students come to me and ask me things that I'm just like, oh my goodness, I don't even know if I feel secure in that area. So let me get back to you. Let me search a little bit there. And I will search there. I will do the forgiveness rituals. I will work on self-worth. I'll do whatever I need to, of course, feel embodied and feel like it's to set myself free ultimately, but it's also to help others. So every day I'm learning something. You think you've healed or you think you've evolved, and then there's something else you didn't even know was there, that something gets triggered or who knows. And that's part of being alive. So I think I'll always be growing. I'll always be learning and changing.
For sure. So as you've kind of embarked on this journey of self-discovery and self-care, what has been something that you've struggled with the most or struggled with recently?
That's a great question. I think recently one of the greatest things I've tackled has actually been judgment. So I actually read Gabby Bernstein's book, Judgment Detox. If anybody is working on judgment, it's a wonderful book. She breaks it down with all these practices. And that was inspired by a student who was going through a really gnarly divorce, and he asked me, how do I work on not judging my ex-wife? And I was like, I want to give you that answer, and I want to make sure that we can do the practices that I know will work, so I'm going to go through it. And I didn't even realize how much work I had to do and how much judgment I had to release, and how big of a cop-out judgment is. When we're judging others, we're afraid of looking at ourselves. We're afraid of what's inside of ourselves and what that brings up in us. So we put up this wall and we judge and we put them in a box. And I didn't realize how much I was doing that and how much that showed me who I was and how much that showed me how much healing I had to do. So that was some big work.
Yeah, for sure. That sounds really interesting. And I think it's really great that as you teach others, you're also learning more about yourself continually. So, can you lead us through a quick meditation or yoga exercise that you think would be helpful for listeners?
Absolutely. So we'll start wherever you are. Just get in a super comfortable seat of your choice or lie down. If you are sitting, allowing both feet to be firmly on the ground, placing your palms face up or face down, whatever feels best to you. Really tuning into your body right here and checking in to see how you can support yourself better just through physical posture. If you haven't already closed your eyes, you're welcome to, or find a soft gaze about a foot in front of you. And let's start by taking 3 deep breaths in through the nose and out through the mouth. And 2 more just like that. In through the nose. And out through the mouth. Allowing your shoulders to fall away from your ears. To soften any tension in the jaw or the face. noticing the seat or the chair, the cushion beneath you, supporting your body. And in this little mini meditation right here, allowing yourself to take a hand to your heart if that feels good. And start by just tuning into your own heartbeat, feeling it, hearing it, experiencing it. I'm using a little mantra, a little mind instrument, a little affirmation. Silently in your mind, telling yourself, I love myself. I love myself. And allowing this phrase, this affirmation to circulate over and over in your mind, silently. I love myself. And before closing, sending a beautiful wave of pure white light, imagining it coming through your palms, your fingertips, into your heart space. Love, healing, support. And slowly and gently allowing your palm to fall into your lap, deepening your breath. Slowly and gently, whenever you're ready, blinking your eyes back open and taking your time throughout the rest of your day. Times are crazy. So giving yourself that love whenever you can, it's so important. You are your own best friend. You have to be.
For sure.
Thank you.
Well, that was awesome. I feel so relaxed. Do some of your students ever fall asleep when they're in class because it's so relaxing and centering?
So often. My teacher, David G, used to say only three things can happen in meditation. You can have thoughts, and that's totally normal and fine. You can experience stillness, which is awesome, or you can fall asleep.
All right. Well, thank you so much for sharing today, Kama. Today, we've been joined by Kama Hagar, who is a yoga instructor, wellness coach, and the founder of Mukama Botanica Skincare. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much, Mackenzie.